Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Couchless Podcast, episode number 270, where my guests are the entire band, the Fastbacks, legendary Seattle prog pop punk rock band, the Fastbacks, who is releasing their first album in 25 years called For What Reason? These guys are champions of naming their albums. For What Reason will be coming out in August. I think the week that this episode comes out is when the record comes out. I've heard it. It's awesome. It was a lot in here. Hopefully we didn't meander too much. I had to move things around. Hopefully if you're watching, it doesn't suck. Hopefully if you're listening, you're just playing along. Hopefully you're just going to play along. But these guys are great. And when I think about Seattle bands, bands that, like, I think about Mudhoney and I think about the Fastbacks. That's who I think about. You know, there are a lot of amazing bands from Seattle and who are still active and vital. But, you know, the Fastbacks are very important. And they have a very powerful motor. I had a great time hosting them. They've been doing this since the 70s, since 1979, late 1979, but they persist. But that's incredible. I don't know any other bands. I mean, Aerosmith just retired. Stones are doing it, but they started in the 60s. They don't count. Who's doing it still from the 70s? And especially anyone from around here. That's incredible. I gotta hand it to those guys, lifers. So I had a great time. I hope that you enjoy this funny, if not, confusing conversation. If you are enjoying the Couchless Podcast, as always, I encourage you to support us on Patreon. Patreon.com/CouchRiffs. This is the only place where you can download the cover songs that CouchRiffs records, produces, and makes videos for. I have another one coming up. Let's see, Muzz and Kurt have both appeared in CouchRiffs covers. Kurt was in Starship Trooper, and I think Muzz was in I Just Want to Celebrate by Rare Earth. So anyway, if you're a Fastbacks fan and you're a completist and you want to get those things, that's the only place you can get it. That's also the only place where CouchRiffs is able to generate any sort of financial support for the content that we create to help support this studio staying alive. And I love living indoors also. So any of that support is massively appreciated. Thank you. Thank you for watching, listening, sharing, doing all the things. As always, remember the golden rule. Treat people the way you want to be treated. Be kind and soft, but be ready. You know, but mostly be kind and soft. And treat people the way you want to be treated. That's it. Don't be a dick.
You guys are cute, right?
Cute's best.
We love parodies.
We like tough, cute.
Fun of things.
This is not a world's record, but for sure a personal best. Most guests on a single episode. How do you guys feel about that?
I think it's great.
What a time.
Deep sense of accomplishment.
I think your place
your entire career has led up to this.
Yeah. Exactly. In a room.
It's all downhill from here.
When people who are not from Seattle think of the Seattle band, they think of probably Pearl Jam or Nirvana, right?
Or Alice in Chains and
Soundgarden.
Yeah. Yeah, bro. I guess you're right.
People from Seattle think of really two bands. I think
Mudhoney
and Fastbacks.
Well, thank you.
Yes.
I don't know if I ever think I'd like to think that, but I feel like okay, I believe you.
Well, I'm curious when you guys think of the Seattle band, who do you think of?
I don't think we ever think of that.
Oh, Heart.
I don't know. Like Flop.
For me, the Young Fresh Fellows.
Oh, okay.
Sure. That's for me.
Yeah, I'd second that.
But But I mean, I think
you can say it to this thing or that. Saying it to me. are you just checking?
I think like, that the microphone is sensitive enough to.
Well, I'm a little sensitive, so please, you know,
go easy.
Me.
Don't
grab me a water.
This poor guy.
So is the microphone.
Let's go real easy. And
you know he's Grammy nominated. We're crying out loud.
That's right, he is.
And he didn't even have water.
I know.
They didn't give him one there either.
No, but you got upgraded on your way home, remember?
It's true. I did get upgraded first class on my flight
you needed
from Los Angeles. You needed
Grammys. Isn't the steward of the gate lady was like,
I was in piss poor condition, and somebody took umbrage upon me, and they gave me a first class upgrade, which I didn't utilize to any degree. I was certainly not going to drink cocktails on the.
You just went on there and slept.
These days, they don't even let you on the plane when you're that way.
I'm just
sleeping is a great thing in first class.
It is A, possible, and B,
restorative.
Restorative.
Yes.
You guys. Your band is 46 years old?
45.
I don't know.
First show, February 1980. First practice was 1979. So, okay. You know, whatever you.
I say 79. Just
whatever you determine as.
It is. And also, 45? It sounds cooler.
79?
Yeah. I don't want to be from the 80s. I mean, we are, but no offense to the 80s, anybody, but.
Makes you sound more punk and less post-punk.
Of course.
That's pop, true.
Punk prog.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm sure that all this has been very, very documented, but how did you guys meet?
High school.
You guys are all from Seattle and went to high school together.
Well, not Kurt and Kim and myself all went to high school together.
Right.
Nathan Hale. Go Raiders.
The whitest school ever, maybe.
Go Raiders. I don't think any of us went to a football.
I did.
I guess maybe I did once.
I did, but not because I liked it. It was just something to do.
Right.
I don't know.
This ain't happening for me.
But yeah, Kim and I met first because Kim was really good friends with my cousin Shannon.
Yeah, she was in we were in the same grade.
And so
together.
We met, and then it was probably like a year later Kurt and I were in photography.
Yeah,
class.
I didn't know you in high school.
Yeah,
no, Kim and I.
I knew who you were because
Kim and I were in the same grade.
But you skipped a grade
through junior high and high school, which it was a little different back then. It was, you know.
7, 8, 9.
3 years in high school is 3 years. We were never in the same class. Any of the same. Like, and you know, the high schools were pretty big, and the junior high was.
That is, I never even thought about that. That is interesting.
And Lulu and I only met in the last quarter of.
Well, you would have been a senior
year.
And I would have been a junior.
Right, but none of us had ever even met each other in high school, even though we were in the same high school for 6 years.
It's unthinkable to me because I grew up in a small town that you could go to school with someone and not.
But I knew about her.
That was my point. It's like, well, how weird is that?
But I knew him because I knew about him because he was on the radio station KNHC at Nathan Hale. So I listened to. I didn't know when it was going to be on. You know, I didn't really understand if they had a program or whatever, but he played good stuff. And he played the first Queen record. And so, like, somebody else knows about this band. I couldn't, you know, I know now people can't imagine that, but back then, nobody knew who Queen was.
Right.
And I think he played Keep Yourself Alive, probably.
Yeah, probably.
I mean
first
or whatever.
Queen record was gold at KNHC.
Yeah. So, sure. But I didn't meet him. I didn't meet you till after high school, I think.
Right, right. We didn't even have met each other in high school. So it's just funny to think that, you know, it's like, oh yeah, we all went to high school and all went to junior high together too. Well, sort of, except none of us had even met. I mean, Jane Addams, a junior high school, you drive by there and it looks like a
prison
correctional facility.
Yeah, it's a really
like that. There was like, you know, 1,000 people.
It looked like that back then.
In grade 7 and 1,200 people in grade 8 and, you know, 1,300.
Yeah.
I don't know
how many there were, but there was, you know, it was the giantest school.
I'm pretty sure at some point we were in the book nook together in the candy shop in Jane Addams without knowing each other who we were. But I probably bought some Lick-A-Maid. That was something.
Oh, that was a thing.
And I even ate the stick.
Why wouldn't you?
That's, I don't know. Some
I
people
was thinking, who didn't?
Sugar.
Oh, I guess I thought I was different.
Just like everyone else.
Yeah, I know. So, yeah. But
I threw my stick at the jocks out of the window of the bus.
The cool bus.
Yeah.
Not the short bus.
I was wearing cool guy shades.
The jocks weren't.
The jocks.
That's the way. Eventually, music brought you guys together, or were you brought together under different, like other social circumstances?
Boredom brought us together.
But music, yes.
Music later, but when.
We just would run around.
I had a photography business that we started after we met in photography class.
Oh, yeah,
class.
You guys have been getting rich together for a long time.
Yeah.
And what am I over here? Chop liver? Simmer down.
But in, you know, there was a photography class at Nathan Hale High School, elective class that you could learn how to take pictures and whatnot. And, you know, I think it was maybe the final semester or whatever
for you.
Yeah, I'll take photography class. That sounds pretty cool. I want to, you know, I know that that thing was there. And so, like, you know, from right from the beginning, there's this woman who's, you know, not really paying attention to any of the lectures or anything like that. And, you know, she would just go into the dark room, and there was, you know, maybe 6 enlargers in a, you know, it was like a proper dark room and a thing with all the chemicals and whatever. And she would always take the best enlarger and have like a little, not a blaster, but just one of those little portable
tape recorder
recorders.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, be blasting out Earth, Wind, and Fire or something like that. And, so, you know, we go to our lecture and then go in to print our pictures and stuff. And it was Lulu, and she was always in there.
Was it Mr. Hoy?
Printing zillions of copies of photos. And one day it's like, wait, is that like David Bowie? Is that Iggy? You know, it's like, whoa, cool. And, you know, the Iggy show that David Bowie
played the keyboards on.
And Blondie was the opening band, you know, whatever that was a few nights before, whatever. And it's like, whoa, you like that kind of music, you know, because
nobody heard of that music in our high school.
Of course, we played, you know, Queen and tons of killer music on KNHC, but, you know, for the most of the people at high school, it was not popular music at that point.
It wasn't Leonard Skinner.
So there was a kinship there, right, in the dark
room. Right. It's like, wow, you like that? That's killer. You know, so I believe it was that summer, the summer of 77.
Well, it was also, there was a lot of shenanigans going on related around going to shows, because we knew ways to, that's how we started hanging out, is just see if we could get into shows that we didn't have tickets for, if we didn't even like the music.
We would sneak in,
yeah. Or Kurt and I and a couple other friends
make tickets.
We learned how to counterfeit tickets,
and they were pretty good. What about?
We started out, it was like we would literally like hand draw these tickets, and they actually would work. I don't think it ever didn't work.
What about the Wings ticket, though? Isn't that the one that had the thing inside, the color?
Well, they started to get pretty.
What kind of tickets are we talking about?
Printed like ones.
Printed concert
John
tickets.
John Bauer presents.
Yeah. Like the sort of like.
Yeah.
Yeah, just a regular ticket. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and they started to get. They started
fancy.
To kind of get make the tickets better. So they were different colored paper in the middle. So when you tear them,
you knew they were not counterfeit for people like us.
And then we're like, okay, how are we going to do that? Oh, you got to get some spray glue and some colored paper and put it in a press.
Did you guys ever get busted?
No, but the first person that went through the styles that got it torn, we were like, are they going to get through? Because, you know.
And that was all connected with the photography thing, because Kurt and I were both into taking pictures. So then you'd have to figure out, how can we get our cameras into the show in order to take the
photo? And we're talking about the Coliseum.
Did you guys ever consider forging a photo pass?
I don't think those really existed back then.
Or maybe. You know, we were 16.
Yeah, 16, 17, 18.
So pretty crafty for 16, but photo passes and the things that stick.
Well, plus the other thing is you'd have to actually, somebody would buy one, so you would have something to actually counterfeit.
Buy one, get as many as you want.
Yeah. And eventually you would start printing them instead of hand drawing them. We finally figured out you could print on this colored paper. So yeah, it was very crafty. And then we would sneak our cameras in, take pictures, and then the next Monday morning we would go into Mr. Hoy's class.
Mr. Hoy's class.
And
I even know. I didn't develop the
print. The
man. So what do you guys think of Napster?
Love it. Love it.
We were just subversive back then.
No, but the point isn't the counterfeit part. The point was that's how we had a kinship with this group of people.
And so that we'd always just drive around at night. Kurt would make mixtapes and we'd drive around at night and maybe break some things.
As young people would.
Yeah, just go to the record stores over and over and
sneak into the class show.
We'd sneak all kinds of stuff at the Paramount.
All kinds of shows. And we met a lot of bands that way too.
Right. Because we were so burly, we would just go down into the stage or the show or the area under the stage at the show at the Paramount.
The green room.
Yes, thank you. We didn't know what that was back then, but we were kind of bold enough to just kind of mingle in that crowd, and security people didn't really. I mean, sometimes I guess they
probably were wondering, because we would sneak in through the fire escape, go up through the dressing rooms. I don't know. You've probably been to the Paramount.
I've been there. Yeah,
how the dressing rooms, and then there's the staircase that'll follow all the way down,
upstairs and downstairs.
Yeah, it'll go. It's the same staircase, and
they don't lock those windows up there for anybody that wants to do that.
Well, that was
they didn't.
They didn't then. Okay, but
Def has a story about sneaking in and seeing the Clash.
Yeah,
were you guys all
I took him there.
Oh yeah,
We were there.
That was one of them.
Bought a ticket for the Clash.
I
sell out.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know.
Well, you know what? You're right, because we still have those tickets.
Yeah, I think.
But we did. We did sneak into their after party.
Oh yeah, that was
for sure
amazing. Because we got to stand in front of each one. I remember Paul Simonet was like draped with all these models around. He's just like fancy models. Like, I'm not talking to those people. And Mick Jones was talking to a group of people, and that he said, our next record is a double record, and I think I said out loud, you can't do that. That's not punk, because nobody's done it. And all these like dudes from the radio station or record company with their
jackets.
Yeah, there's
always radio stations.
They turned around and looked at me like, who is this person? Like, oh,
how dare you say that?
But of course, like Ted Nugent had done that. Nobody, no punk band had done that before.
Right.
And then, of course, Joe Strummer, I listened to him the most. He was just talking to people.
We gave Joe Strummer a tape of the Cheaters.
Did you?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, all right, we'll listen to this, and if we like it, we'll play it, you know, on the PA tomorrow in Portland.
Oh, wow.
So, I don't know if he did, but...
Well, we talked to him.
It's funny that I don't remember Duff being there, but it doesn't surprise me at all.
Oh, he was there. And then our friend Jeff Larson, everybody decided, like, let's go over the balcony, the orchestra pit? Let's go on one. Let's rush the stage. And nobody did but our friend Jeff Larson. He got his nose punched in. but they stopped the show, and didn't one of them, Mick Jones or Paul Simon, grab a fire axe off the wall?
Joe Strummer grabbed the axe.
They didn't
stop the show, but it was in the middle of the song. And he went back and got the axe and threatened the security.
Yeah, he's like, you go outside.
With not just a little, it was a big.
It wasn't a hatchet.
It was no hatchet.
It was an axe.
Full-on axe.
It was tough.
Yeah.
I think Jeff.
And then, of course, it riled up the whole audience, because you're like,
let's get him. Let's kill people.
Let's get
talk about a white riot.
That's right.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
How long after these shenanigans did you guys decide that you were going to make a band?
Kurt. Drums. It all came down to...
No, it was actually that show. I always remember. I always... Because you guys were already in a band.
Right.
And I was not. But we went to this show in Edmonds, and I can't remember the name of the band, but it was really bad, and I just said, that band sucks so badly that... I think we should start a band because it would be better.
I remember going to that show.
You know, some really bad, like, Loverboy kind of band or something. I don't remember, but do you remember that at all?
No, I don't. Do not remember at all. At all.
A show in Edmonds then.
Well, they had a...
Was it Edmonds Theater?
Yeah.
I think so.
They had bands playing.
Maybe it was Shannon and I, and we probably said, let's start a band.
Yeah, because I don't remember any bands that would have played at Edmonds Theater that would have been bad.
Yeah, I can't remember who it was, but, and you said, I'll play the drums, because you were playing the guitar at that point, and you all play drums.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And Kim then, already was playing in a band, so.
I was playing in a band.
Kim was the bass player in the Radios, and a band was guitar that... player in the Cheaters, who were sort of, we practiced in my parents' basement, and, you know, there was always a drum set in the basement, so we'd go down there and play drums every so often, if there was nobody home, and you know, when the Cheaters discombobulated, would have been October 79. You know, just been down there playing drums, and it's like, well, you know, you guys can come over and play. There's all this band gear there. I mean, not all this band gear. Like, there was a whole bunch of band gears, bunch of junk. It was our junk.
And Shannon was going to be the singer, her cousin.
Yeah, my cousin.
But she was too shy, so she never uttered a beat.
She stayed in the band until we got a show, which was only 3 months later.
But she never sang.
Is that right?
I never sang in this band. Yeah. I never ever sang. She sang.
And I sang at the beginning, even though it was horrible, but... I think you did sing a song.
I sang Manus Hunter, the Cheaters song, but that was later.
But not at that show. Anyways,
believe you sang Manus Hunter at the first show.
Yeah, saying in general, I didn't sing in the very beginning.
Yeah. And that was the now famous Veins Psychopop
Fastback
show that was at the
Laurelhurst Rec Center.
Yeah. The Laurelhurst Rec Center, which is a very small
community. Still there.
Is that right?
Yeah.
We had our photo taken for the as many weirdos as possible thing.
You guys should do a show there.
That would be so... Actually, that would be really fun.
We play the same songs we played at the...
And maybe the same cops can come.
Before I forget, I had an idea. If you guys wanted to have a release party that was a listening party aside from the Easy Street thing,
mm-hmm.
Make karaoke mixes of all your songs and have a Fastbacks karaoke party.
You guys have
enough material to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's actually pretty great.
You must
That's really great.
A lot of the master tapes.
I do. I do.
As a matter full of fact, ideas. I do.
That would be funny.
Karaoke night. Fastbacks karaoke.
I love that.
Not bad.
It's hot. It's a hot idea.
And it might start a trend.
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And Kim can be the host. Okay. Now we'd like to get...
Let's give a shout out to my friend...
AJKB.
Shout out. Okay, everybody. Give it up for my friend. Give a shout out. Who's going to come up here and sing a little Gone to the Moon for ya. All right. Give it up. Just a shout out.
Who doesn't like a good shout out?
In 1980, when you guys played that show, could you have possibly imagined band surviving and putting out a record in 2024?
No, because the first show we did was, I think we were widely considered by everyone, including partially ourselves, to be kind of a joke band.
Yeah.
And...
Played mostly covers. Probably unrecognizable to most people.
Did we?
At the first show.
Yeah, almost all covers?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I have a tape of it. And you can pretty much, the tape is pretty hard to discern what's going on. There's, and, but you can tell at least what the songs were for the most part. There's one that I don't have any idea what it was. It could be an original song, but, you know, it was, I don't, of course nobody thought it would, there was any future in it. It was kind of a no future.
We didn't. Band. I know I didn't.
Yeah.
I thought it was just fun for now and.
Yeah, it's the whole never reason really. We started and never it never stopped. It was always because we wanted to have fun.
Yeah.
Right.
I think.
Yeah.
How many records have you guys recorded and released?
I don't know, Kurt. No. It's hard to say because...
You don't even know?
Well, no. You'd be surprised.
What you call a yeah, and it depends.
Including
does it have
all
to be,
the singles, all
yeah.
the...
Yeah, does it have so to be LPs? All original?
That's everything. What they that's did back in the day. They would call it a record. Oh, we made a record.
But
a
for,
single.
For 45 years as a band together, if you count LPs or albums, it's not that many. I mean, for a band that's been together this long, I don't know.
We're all adding them up.
Actually, yeah, I know. Everybody's thinking. I mean, do you have any idea how many songs? Maybe that would be a better way to do
or it. Or Scott Lee, we need him.
I don't know. The historian.
Yes.
Super
yes.
fan.
Yes, the super fan.
Okay, so this, I mean, going through this in this sort of traditional couch riff style would take us all day.
Okay.
So.
Just the highlight reel?
What I wish to do. Is hit the highlights.
Yeah.
So.
Who doesn't?
I know that, right? I know that might be tricky, especially because four perspectives, right? But surely some perspectives will align. What was the first moment that you guys can remember? And this is obviously pre-mic. What is the first moment that you guys recall thinking... were a real band, considering that you started out, as you say, feeling like a bit of a joke.
I think it's just we started playing shows. And I don't know if I guess I felt like we were kind of a real band. The bands we were playing with weren't that good either. They're just kind of punk bands. And
can I quote you on that?
Well, I'm just saying, like, nobody was, like, perfect.
Right.
So it was attainable just to do what we were doing. I don't know. I didn't know how to get any better. We just kept playing shows.
Yeah, I think you just keep doing it, and at no point, you know, there wasn't like a whole lot of looking back or anything. You just do what you do. You know, I don't think there was any grand thing. It's like, okay, we better start taking this serious now. We're starting to move some units or, you know, anything like that. You know, you just play and... Gosh, we've been a band for
five months.
Almost, yeah, yeah. Well, interestingly enough, like I think, you know, our first single came out in 1981, so you know we fumbled along 1980, where I was the drummer, and then I just spoke to Duff yesterday when we were going over this. This day that, you know, people just, how old were we? 19, 18, Duff was probably 16 or 15.
Yeah.
And everybody's just hanging out.
15.
Daytime. Nobody had like a full-time job except Kim, maybe, but she'd probably leave early.
Or didn't go in that.
So it would just.
Or to dental labs.
You know, middle of the summer, hanging out, sitting around, doing absolutely nothing. And maybe we were going to go downstairs and practice.
Oh, we were doing stuff. We were driving around every night.
Right, but I mean, like the daytime.
Forging tickets.
Nobody was doing anything. And Duff said, well, I'm here. Let me play drums today with your band, and you play guitar and see what that sounds like. That also just as a way to, you know, make an afternoon a little more interesting.
He also lied about the fact that he could play drums.
Oh, yeah, no, nobody right? had any. I don't think anybody had heard of
drums before.
It's funny. He turns out that he lived, like, around, his mom's house was right around the corner from the Fastback house, right. Where me and Lulu lived with somebody else. And so it was just so easy. Came over, and first song we played together, Baby Blue by Badfinger. Right?
And, And so, and you know, it was just a way to entertain an afternoon, but we never went back. You know, and
once
that was
switched to guitar,
right, and then by the end of, you know, like whenever it was, whatever the next shows we played, and then we recorded songs for our first single, in the early 1981, I think. I mean, so there was no plans or anything like that. Just stuff. We just sort of did stuff out of boredom, and
it just happened sort of organically. But for me, I think the first tour was what for me made us a quote unquote real band.
That was
and
my
that,
next
but
question.
That wasn't until
and you booked it,
Musburger.
Right?
I mean, not
no.
Musburger.
No. Richard.
That wasn't until Richard,
right? Drummer
and
number
so,
three for those keeping track.
Yeah, and that was 82, correct? Sorry, I'm not good with dates. But
first tour? No.
Really?
84.
What? Really? Okay. Yeah. I believe you. Anyway, so that would be for me, I'd say, when it's like, okay, let's go out and we'll be a real band. And, you know, I think it was with DOA.
We did shows with DOA.
Thank you. I
have toured with DOA.
Yeah, that was.
Well, toured with them,
we
maybe.
We went on shows on the West Coast, yeah.
West Coast, yeah.
I mean, that's a tour for a young band. Yeah. It's like,
oh, no,
what cities did you guys hit on that tour?
This is West Coast stuff. I mean, we knew
probably
them
like
Vancouver.
Well, actually, I think Sacramento was one, but like.
Problems.
San Francisco, Portland, LA.
Mix up those ones. There's Sacramento. There's the Crest Theater with DOA
and
the Circle.
And Problem Fish.
Problem Fish and Tales of Terror, I believe.
Oh, that's right. That's so crazy.
You know, there's. But that's sort of almost like another, you know, facet that 1981 was kind of an interesting year because. There, in some ways, there was a music explosion in a lot of ways. You know, bands like DOA and Black Flag and, you know, bands started Husker Du. Bands started, you know, in punk bands.
Well, like the roadmap was being forged.
Right.
And like
the people started doing stuff. So we ended up being friends with a lot of people in Vancouver, BC, DOA.
We played up there
Sticks,
more than
Subhumans,
more than Seattle.
Know, some of those bands, and so we ended up going up to Vancouver all the time and playing. In fact, we did do more shows in Vancouver in 1981 than we played in Seattle, just
Whoa.
Because it was more fun. And the drinking age was 18.
Yeah,
that helps.
And the beer was higher.
High test.
Yeah, high test beer. I mean,
that stuff was like
all those
lethal.
Were good reasons.
So we ended up having a bunch of friends up in Vancouver. Ron Ray's.
I thought the bands were better up there too.
They were. I mean, it was more, you know, down here.
It was an established scene. The Smiling Buddha really kind of was a place to be.
And they
kind of
took us in. And we knew.
Right. We'd always go up there and play Smiling Buddha Friday and Saturday night, where there was nothing similar to that in Seattle. I mean, the drink age was 18, so you had to be 18 to go. But we could come up with our buddies, go hang out, you know, have a place to sleep and play the next night. You know, all the things that you wanted that we didn't have in Seattle. And then, you know, DOA is like, well, we've got these shows. Do you want to get on them? And it's like, ooh,
yes,
of course. Yeah. How do we do that? It's like,
well, they would come down to Seattle, too. There's a club called The Bird, the first punk club. And they were there a lot. That's, I think I first saw them ever.
But I think Vancouver is more receptive to our kind of music.
Yes.
Down here, there was hardcore bands and there was bar bands, but there was nothing.
Or new wave bands.
There was, you know, there was the new wave bands, but they all wanted to be bar bands. I mean, they would all, if they were successful, they'd play, you know, at the Hall of Fame and the Rainbow and stuff like the new wave bands, the safer bands, and then the, you know, the hardcore bands, the Farts or whatever would.
But we'd get on those shows a lot because we were kind of loud and scrappy. We weren't really a hardcore band.
No, no, not at all.
But we'd end up on those kind of bills.
Hardcore fun.
That's right.
Exactly.
That's what I was going to say.
You got that right.
So after the first tour, was it energizing? And did that feel like an addictive experience, or were you guys like, well, what do we do now?
Well, I think by that point, we had put out three records by the time we went on that first tour. We put out a 45 and two 12-inch EPs. And, you know, so, yeah, we were probably absolutely taking things a little more serious. Because by that point, also, we'd probably broken up maybe only once.
And how many drummers by that time?
There was sometimes a little bumpy road there that would come along.
And how many drummers? It was me, Duff, Richard Stuverud.
And then Danny Zachos.
Then Richard Stuverud.
Then Richard Stuverud again. There was a few one-show drummers, Tad Hutchison, Tom Hendrickson.
And also one practice people. Like, didn't Andy Davenhall just come over for one?
We don't even talk about it. He wasn't really even, yeah.
I'm just saying, people say in the moment. Yeah, that you have so many drummers, there's some that didn't really spend too much time with us.
But so, yeah, we continued on trying to make something of ourselves.
Once you put out a record, and you know, back then you would put them in things and send them to radio stations, send them to Flipside and Maximum, and you know, you'd send them to everyone that you possibly think could pay attention to you. You know, so I guess at that point you're getting kind of serious.
But I was gonna say, even though we were all getting more serious, it was really hard to get any recognition. I mean, our band just wasn't, it didn't fit into any mold. I don't think anyways, but we didn't,
no,
we didn't care except that we wanted people to come to the shows. That was, and right, to buy the records and listen to them. But it was pretty tough at that time. Well, and again, going back to what you were saying, because there weren't a lot of clubs. What was the club that was down in Pioneer Square?
Central.
The Metropolis.
Oh, Metropolis.
Yeah, the Metropolis. Finally, and then we had the Gorilla Gardens.
Yeah.
So there was a little bit. By 1983 or something, there was sort of places to play. And that's when we sort of rehydrated, I guess. By summer of 1982, I think we were done and dusted.
But then came back.
And then we came back and, you know, just sort of picked up where we left off, I guess.
I would say too that the next thing was when Sub Pop would put out a record. I mean, that to me was the next.
That was a little ways
that
off.
It was 80s. A little ways off. Yeah,
because at that point we had a new drummer named
Pop Llama record,
Nate Johnson.
Which
we put out two records on Pop Llama too.
Yeah, that's right.
I would say fantastic records.
Me too.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, but I'm not saying that. But those were
a lot to just sort of look over.
You mean just to sort of gloss over?
Gloss over.
That's true.
I think I wrote some pretty good.
It's nothing to do with the
songs. I'd like
songs.
To be acknowledged for my work.
Give the man another water for Christ's sake. Damn.
Give me that fucking water back.
Not a lot of thanks and praise.
I mean, that's the era that I became aware of the Fastbacks, is those records, because I was in high school and saw them play at like a Mural Amphitheater when they do all ages shows.
Thank you, Conrad.
Right.
Yeah.
Conrad.
Yeah. I'm in the crowd at the.
There were not a lot of bands back then that had women in them. It was
well,
not.
If there were,
as,
they were singers.
Right?
Tambourine players.
You guys
players.
Are both singers.
But I'm saying they didn't play an instrument.
Oh, they were tambourinists, is what you're saying?
Yeah, there really weren't that many. Mm-hmm. But we still do have that poster that says. Two mostly women bands.
It was a battle of the bands.
Oh, yeah, it was a battle of the bands.
Visible targets.
Oh, yeah.
Two mostly women bands. Like, well, there's four of us, and if two of us are...
That's not mostly.
Two mostly men bands.
Or whatever. And by the way, we lost the battle of the bands to the Visible Targets.
We did,
night,
just to officially make that, put that out there.
Let you know that we have won no competitions.
Look who's still standing, though.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's right.
But so, yeah, to answer your question, yes, there were not that many.
Did you guys feel like that created any extra hurdles for you as a punk band? Maybe not.
No,
I don't think we thought
no.
like that.
We didn't think. Kim and I never thought that way.
No, I didn't.
It was
really
it
care.
Was like the one journalists would often ask us. So, what's it like being a woman in a band?
Right.
And we'd always go, "Well, it's hard to compare because we've never been a man in a band. It's you know, we're people in band.
What's it like being a man in a band?
Exactly. Yeah. So that was always
fucking
you
great.
Get on stage
yeah,
and play
yeah,
music,
it's,
right?
It's awesome being a woman in a band. Because
right. I think there's also like, do you feel threatened by men taking your job? Like you're gonna. Remember there's people that would talk about...
No, I don't remember that. Yeah.
Girls in bands would say, well, a guy, they just, I don't know. It wasn't what I ever thought.
No, it's not how Kim and I were not.
We're just like tomboys. Yeah. You know? We just played rock music.
And it was cool. I mean, obviously, because there were other super cool women in rock bands, right? You know, whether it was the Runaways or...
But not a lot in Seattle at that point.
Yeah. Or there would be bands like the Bangles or something like that. But that wasn't our scene either. Yeah. But there were enough, like, you know, it's like Lita Ford was pretty cool.
Yeah.
So.
And Joan Jett, obviously.
Well, obviously. Yeah.
So you guys put your first string of records out yourselves, and then Pop Llama happens, yeah?
Yes, I think we sort of tricked them into putting out our first album.
That's cool.
How did you do that?
Well, they were like, well, let's put out a 45. And I even have the, you know, paste up artwork for the first Fastbacks 45. And then at some point we're like, well, you know, it costs this much to make a 45. It only costs, a little bit more to make a full album. Maybe we should just do that. And they're like, oh, let's stick with the 45 and see how that goes. Somehow it got bolstered into an LP. And that was great. I think the record did well and, you know, sold out its copies over the years. And, you know, we ended up being pals with the Pop Llama. What was Conrad Uno and Scott McCoy were the Pop Llama team at that time. And then, I mean, I guess because, you know, at least half of that first record was recorded at Egg Studio. And when Uno moved to Ravenna and opened his, you know, slightly more spacious studio. that's where the record label things were happening too, in an adjacent room. And so it was really easy to go there to record stuff, you know, whether, I don't know that we ever probably forked over very much money for studio.
So wait, the original Egg location was smaller than the basement studio.
Oh yeah.
Wasn't that on like Fifth?
In Northgate.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I remember. And, in a garage, right?
Wow. It was in garage. Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know, it was set up like a proper studio. There was a little place to play music, and you know, a tiny little control room, and a you know, four track to begin with, and. I believe, did we record on four track to start with?
I wouldn't know.
It came to me in a dream that was on the Pop Llama sampler album.
We did that in that a rehearsal space down underneath Ground Zero. Didn't we do the beginning part? We recorded that?
No, that was later. That was a cassette recording.
Okay.
But the Pop Llama one, we'd recorded, I don't know. Every time anybody asked us to record one song for something, we'd go in and record like four or six of them. So there was clearly enough room at the original Egg to get all of us in there.
Sure.
And things went well enough that we would want to start, that we'd want to keep playing and play as many songs as we could. So that came out, and then I guess people... It was notorious enough that it led to our album. And then once we had our foot in that door, we had no problem going in there to record as many things as we could over the next few
years. If the door's cracked open, kick it down.
Or just, you know, just put a little stone so it doesn't close. You know, we don't have to kick down any doors, but we want to keep a wedge in there to keep them open.
You guys have a rich history of sneaking in.
That's
very
right.
Much.
I suppose so.
If you got that open door...
We're coming over.
And if there's not an open door, look for a window.
Of course.
Exactly.
If you make tickets, we'll forge them.
When the Sub Pop deal came along, did you guys feel like you'd hit the big time?
It wasn't really a deal.
Right.
Well, I mean, it wasn't. They weren't signing us. They just said, we put out Question Is No, right? The first. When they put out a single first.
Put out a double single. Well,
oh, yeah.
By the time... The second Fastbacks album, Very, Very Powerful Motor, came out in 1989,
maybe? Yeah, it was 89.
Yeah. It was recorded in February 1988, right as 1988 was a perilous year for the Fastbacks. And
I was not well.
Maybe it didn't come out till 1990, but I was had boxes of records, as one would do to take them around to record stores. And I guess we'd already had a song on Sub Pop 200.
Yes.
So we, you know, that door
the wedge
had
was
a foot in it, and maybe a little, not a wedge to keep it open or a big stone or anything, but, you know, like a, there was like a piece of paper to keep the latch from latching.
Piece
of course,
of,
you know what I'm talking
a
about.
A piece of tape over
absolutely.
The...
Absolutely.
In case you, yeah. know what I'm, yes. you know what I'm talking about. and I would go down to the Sub Pop, as well as being a record label, we're a record distributor. And they were, you know, right downtown on First Avenue. So I would go there, not every week, but every few weeks I'd go down
every
there.
Day.
And just go through their warehouse of records. And, you know, I was friends with John from playing music and whatnot. So, not like he'd give me anything I wanted, but, you know, get records for wholesale prices. You know, like, good. And that's pretty good if you're, you know, record guy. You
sure.
want new records. And then, you know, one day it's like, where are you going now? It's like, I'm going up to Selfing Square to drop off some records. Like, oh, can I come with you? And, you know, I'm just going to bring some records too. I mean, it was all really ground level at that point. He had a box of records to bring to Cellophane. And you did too. And so did I.
And at that point, you kind of look like you're being distributed by Sub Pop.
Yeah. Well, you walked in with the Sub Pop guy and you both had records. And so, you know, then he's like, well, what would you folks think about doing a single for Sub Pop? And of course, we'd love that. And by that point, it must have been 1990 at that point.
I had just started working there. That was the beginning of my 7 years.
Libbity-jibbity.
Yeah, so I
what
actually...
What year did you start working there?
90, but I actually started before I had the receptionist job. I was working in the... I was stuffing our single. That's the first time. You know, you can come in and you can... They had a bunch of people stuffing the singles, and so I do that, and he goes, and we could pay you $5 an hour, or you could get, you know, records. What do you want? So, and then when I was there one day, Megan Jasper came downstairs. She was working there before she... what she does now, and she said, would you want to do the receptionist half a day every day? Like, yeah, I don't know how to do that, but I'm sure it'll be fun. So I did that for like 3 years. And
you like talk to people? Yeah,
I talked to the coolest people. Yeah, I had some funny conversations with Kim Fowley.
Wow.
There's all kinds of people, but anyway, and then I ended up working there till 97.
Oh, that long? I didn't realize it was that long.
Yeah, kind of a while. Surprised it lasted that long, to tell you the truth. But
you guys have seen the Seattle music scene go through everything, mm-hmm. essentially. Yeah?
Yeah.
I know this is well documented, but the 90s was decidedly different for this. There was a lot of growing pains.
Mm-hmm.
How did you guys keep that fun for yourselves?
We didn't get signed by a major label. I mean,
no major label was ever even interested.
No, they weren't.
We never got taken out to dinner. I think we talked about
that. Is that right? Never
we
once?
Never once. Got taken out to dinner. We crashed other people's dinners.
Yeah, we went to a lot of dinners, but they weren't for us.
Yeah. We'd go to them, but never.
What was the best dinner that you guys crashed?
I don't know.
I think it was the Melvins that was up at, what's that place called? Charlie's up on Broadway?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I think there was a pretty good table there.
I don't even remember.
That's where they decided to have the label take them to fucking Charlie's?
I think that's where it was.
Charlie's was pretty great. I miss that place.
Yeah. Sure, but like, you could... You know, on payday, you could take yourself there.
It wasn't so much about the steaks, but the drinks.
Yeah, so it didn't matter.
You know, maybe we had some steak frites or something like that. I don't know.
Or a casserole.
Steak casserole.
Steak casserole.
Steaks is high.
Snake casserole.
So, you know, it was more just about hanging out with the giant table, your buddies, and having some laughs.
It was fun back then because there was something to do every night if you wanted to. There's all kinds of stuff going on.
Yeah, then there were a lot. It was like every night you could go to a club.
Yeah, and that's when we actually started touring, is 90s. That's when we actually went to the East Coast for the first time and, you know, started doing it.
What was that like?
Well, I'd never been to New York, so it was interesting. It was big. It was fun back then, you know? I mean,
what was that tour? Who were you guys out with?
We were just on our own, weren't we?
Motocaster.
Was that Motocaster, the first one with New York?
Mike, were you in the band then?
Yeah, I started playing with them in 92.
91?
91. Yeah, 91 was my first tour.
What?
Yeah.
But it gets kind of weird because...
I've been around a while.
Because then Rusty turns out to be on Zucker, so he tours with us a little bit, and then John Moen.
That was later, wasn't it?
Yeah, John Moen was later.
John Moen was 94.
I thought Rusty was too. I thought he was a lot later.
Well, I started the Zucker record is when I started playing with you guys.
Pretty sure Rusty was West Coast tour. Early 91.
Yeah.
Probably Mike late 91 into 92.
Yeah.
Then
you're still in the Posies.
I did both for years. Yeah.
I had no idea.
You didn't know that? Huh.
Who played drums on the Pearl Jam tour? You did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That was 96.
Yeah.
Oh, what?
He was in. He was a veteran.
My timeline.
He was in there for a long time.
I was pretty messed up in the 90s.
Mike is the longest
and
running.
We did Pearl Jam shows in 95 as well, a handful of
them. Those two, the Spartan Stadium and
Delta Center
in Salt Lake City, yeah.
As far as, typical events that happen in a band's career, it happens with the podcast, you're looking forward to a specific event, we're going to put this record out, it's going to change everything. Eventually you realize nothing is
I don't think we never huge. Thought that was going to happen
it's not going to change
anything. Yeah,
but touring with Pearl Jam, that wasn't
going to change anything for us except for the time we're doing it,
right?
But I mean, it wasn't going to make us big famous rock stars.
That's the pinnacle of touring in 1995.
Well, no doubt.
It was
absolutely
the best tour
you
could have done, for sure.
Yeah,
it was.
Did you guys go everywhere with them?
I think we did all their 96 shows.
So
we even went as far as Turkey. We played Istanbul.
Yeah.
We did
all
that.
Yeah.
I've never been.
It was like 2 weeks in the U.S. and then like three or something like that.
Yeah, it was
the
East Coast leg and then Europe.
Yeah, Europe. Oh, we did the Seattle show too.
Did you guys also go to Japan?
Yeah, but not with them.
That was with John Moen.
John Moen.
That was
93.
That was 93.
Because I was on. And I was previously engaged.
With Sub Pop. I mean,
that was the greatest thing in the world. So of course
they brought us there, and we were there with the Super Suckers and Super Snaz
and Seaweed.
That's right.
A tour.
And Seaweed. It was really fun.
Because Sony
small,
had
but...
just merged, and so they wanted to bring it over and do a Sub Pop Blame Fest to introduce.
That was
the
a bunch of money.
Yeah.
No better way to lose some money than
to spend it.
I mean, we had our own hotel rooms in a 5-star hotel room.
Yeah,
I still
really
find
great.
That to be a luxury.
That is actually outrageous.
It is a luxury.
That's unbelievable
to have your own room.
But we didn't know what to do. Lulu would come to my room in the morning because we're jet lagged. She's like, "Are you up? I'm watching weird Japanese cartoons. Come on in." It's not like you sleep really well when you first get there. Well, you do, just different time periods.
But yeah, I think that actually the Pearl Jam thing was pretty unique too, in that it's like we weren't getting the first class treatment by any means, but just the fact that Pearl Jam, they were very open arms about hey, we want these guys on here and treat them really nicely and everything. But it's not like we were touring in a tour bus or anything with them.
Right.
But it was really cool to play those huge stadiums.
It was amazing.
Because we'd never done it and we have never done it since. But to get to go out on those stages and, every once in a while, Eddie would go out ahead and say,
and how about
hey,
having
you
the guy
know.
Walk up with his flashlight to take you on the stage? I'd seen that all my life. I want a piece of that.
I want a flashlight guy.
And he's the guy that lowers the lights. Okay, they're ready. And And people like
flash out to the front of house.
Yeah, with the little code.
Yeah. Okay. But that was like so exciting.
Oh, and the guitar tech.
Sorry.
What's going on over there? Oh. Guitar tech had an espresso machine.
Oh, yeah, that was wild.
In his guitar tech cabinet.
Oh, yeah.
And so, we got there 5 minutes before showtime.
Have an espresso.
And he'd make us all.
Oh, that's a dangerous
double
game.
Espressos.
Oh, yeah.
I hope your set was short.
Pretty good. 40 minutes.
I've had to do a number 2 minutes before I go on stage every time. Coffee.
Oh, yeah, they have a toilet on the stage.
Oh, they have a toilet inside of the rolling road case.
Yeah. I don't remember that.
It's an outhouse.
You open the door and it's like an outhouse.
It's an outhouse.
It says guitar tech. That's
just got, you know. It's got one of those little moons.
Gibson Les Paul series.
Yeah.
Pearl Jam has always been a champion for local bands, and they remain that. Like
they do, which is so cool.
Yeah.
They're huge music fans.
Cool. It's very cool.
Yeah. When you guys came home, did you guys have a champion's return? It's pretty funny coming home.
We had a ticker tape parade down at
Fifth House. I mean, our shows in town after that year were bigger. More people would come to see us play. There definitely was a bump after that. You know,
we got better too.
We'd sell out the Crocodile. We'd sell out Moe's. There was a bit of a bump for sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Where did it all go wrong?
Yeah, that's your next thing. Milestone. Okay, we found the trajectory up and then the cliff came
down.
I guess the question I have is the big question I have is for other people, not even for me. Because I don't give up because what else am I gonna do? And I suspect that is also your answer, but What's the secret to the longevity of your band? Like, this band could have broken up. And
oh, it
you
did.
Guys could
it
have
has.
Done
we broke other... up several times, and we have been broken up for 25 years. So you want to rephrase that question.
But you have remained at least semi-regularly active.
Not really, though.
Come on.
You haven't played a show for...
Right. We played what?
Two shows when I got home in 2018.
Right. We haven't really done anything.
Prior to that was 2011.
My theory is...
In the early
and I don't think anyone...
Well, I had a kid. That was part of it.
My theory is that the fact that we were never very popular and never sold any records and never really got anywhere. There was never any money to argue over. So... It's still fun to get together and go out to have lunch and tell stories and have some laughs and stuff. Where so many bands that, you know, people got mad and angry and it's like, well, you know, I should have had a credit on that one song or whatever bands do that they get angry about. You know, maybe we don't have that same.
We didn't have pressures like
problem.
That.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, you guys can take that and run with it or just not.
No, I think that's pretty accurate. Yeah.
I mean, having been in bands that had those pressures myself, I like being in this band. In fact, this is the only band
name
I actually,
one.
This is the only band I actually want to be in because it is fun.
You know, and
bands
and
are a dumb idea.
At this point, we generate enough income to go buy ourselves lunch every couple months.
That's nice.
And apparently make a record, too.
Yeah, and that's how the new record came about.
Well, I don't know if we've made that much money
yet. Not yet. Well, it hasn't come out yet. Hopefully it'll...
We're going to make $1 million with this one, for sure.
Yeah, this is going to... This is like, finally going to break us.
You guys have been getting rich for a long time.
Yeah.
Just aren't there yet.
Oh.
Getting rich.
August 28th, that's going to change.
Yeah.
What advice do you have to young bands that are starting? Like, don't... famous.
Don't start.
Yeah, the first one
don't
is
do it.
Yeah.
No.
Get a real job and then start a band and have fun and see what happens.
Yeah.
Is that really your advice?
I don't know. It's what I did.
That's the opposite of my advice. Don't get a job.
I don't know.
I've never had a brief.
If you're young enough, go for it.
I've always had, well, not anymore, but I've always, during our band, I've always had some kind of a job that wasn't music, sip, sip, pop.
Yeah.
Well, you got to, I mean, if you like living indoors, you have to have money or rich parents, and I don't have that.
Yeah. I do like living indoors.
Oh man, it's cool.
It's isn't the best.
It is so good. Great.
I live in a car.
Not outside.
Also not
in outside. The garage.
If you're young enough, go for it. Give yourself some time to try to make it work, but probably have something to fall back on. That would be mine. I don't know.
I don't know, but I think just enjoy every moment that you can, which is not always easy if you're, you know, sharing a room in a Motel 6 or whatever. Yeah. But
there's nothing wrong with sharing a room I was gonna in say, Motel 6.
In retrospect, I didn't those say experiences that
that's,
are really fun.
That's what I was just going to say. So we had four people recognize in one. That.
Five people
despite
in Motel
that.
6 can get a little, a little bit crowded. But there's nothing wrong with four people in a Motel 6.
But I remember when we upped it to Super 8s.
Oh, yeah.
Right, two more.
Like, yeah, we're going to try a Super 8, and like, that's going to be really expensive.
Yeah, that's $5 more.
And you actually get a full-length towel instead of the
both. Did you guys ever get to the Days End sort of
range? We did, actually. Yeah. Except for, like Jim said, when we were in Japan.
The BW?
No, we didn't.
Travel Lodge.
Howard Johnson's.
Howard Johnson's got a waffle maker in that lobby.
Some of them do.
They got some mojo,
you know, Days
too.
In does, too.
Travelodge up in Bellingham.
Oh.
Definitely saw some...
drunk people.
Bad behavior.
some behavior. Yeah.
Those shows were crazy.
No, but that was my point, is despite staying at a Motel 6, figure out how to have fun anyways and recognize that. I think that's the best thing.
In this group is a good example. I mean, he records other bands, produces other bands. She works in the film industry, which is definitely music adjacent. Right. Kim worked at our record label for years. And I'm the drummer, so I played in 40 bands.
Still playing.
Still playing 40 bands.
And do lots of production.
And that, yeah, and then like, that morphed into production work, touring production work. Tour, so it was all music adjacent
Mr.
for all
Ringo
of us.
Star.
Like highbrow production work.
Well, it was turned into that. But that was recent, you know. This I'm talking about 20, 25, 30 years ago, you know.
When you were a youngster.
Yeah, when we were all youngsters, younger than we are now, yes. We all had other things going on in sort of in the industry or adjacent to it to help keep it going.
Getting older.
Mm-hmm.
Not saying you guys are older, but you're older than you were when we started talking.
So much.
That's true.
And getting older, your perspective on just being alive changes, of course. How has your perspective on music changed?
Still listen to the same stuff I've always listened to.
What's the newest band you've gotten
Red
into?
Red Cross. Oh, that I've gotten into?
Red Cross.
Well, newest band
I think you said
Red
the newest
Cross.
Record.
Yeah, it was only 50 years ago.
Newest band? I like older bands mostly.
But so that's the question.
But that's not
what's
question.
The newest band you can think of?
I don't know.
Partridge Family?
ABBA?
Strokes.
I heard this new band, The Strokes. They're pretty good.
The
White Strokes. You should check them out.
You can't name a new. You can't
I have
name
to think
a,
about
a
it.
I don't
band.
Go out to see bands. I don't know.
Yeah. Don't That's know. Okay.
Yeah, it is for me.
You don't care.
It's not that I don't care. It's just that I don't do that.
It's not on your radar. Mike?
I try. I go in phases of paying attention to new music. And I don't know. I saw Madison Cunningham the other day play at a festival, and she was amazing.
Oh,
not punk at all, but God, what amazing music.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, yeah.
Is she like Grand Funk kind of?
But yeah, exactly like Grand Funk. Totally. Yeah, she's got a Mark Farner thing going on. I really like the new Red Cross record.
Yeah, that's the greatest record in the world. Yeah.
The whole freak out scene here in Seattle is kind of fun. There's a lot of good music happening in our city that the kids are going out to see, which is heartening that there's a young crowd going to see loud rock and roll with guitars again, which kind of didn't happen for a long time. So that's cool. Yeah.
I love that too.
Yeah.
There's a kind of a, like a roots music scene here.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's like interesting.
Americana stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's been going on for a while.
But it's like the 5.0, version 5.0.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Like they're fully morphed from the Flying Burrito Brothers to the Eagles now, however. So I don't know if it's as cool as it used to be.
That's not good.
I don't know.
That's a bad morph.
Exactly.
But teach their own.
Yeah, it's funny what comes through. I don't have anything for you, sir.
Really? Nothing? Not even through your kids?
I'll think about it.
Like nothing even like.
Yeah, see, I'm saying.
Ambient, like.
Jason, I'll have to think about it. Because I'm sure there is, but it's just nothing's popping to the surface.
I'll tell you this. I listened to first Blue Oyster Cult record before I came here today.
First Beatles record?
Great.
Blue Oyster Cult record.
Oh, BOC.
I'm kind of on a kick for that.
That's Beatles Oyster Cult.
That'd be a good one.
A cold brew oyster cult. Ah.
Yeah.
Kurt, what about Kurt, it's your turn, Kurt.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Isn't it weird? Burien?
What's that?
Burien?
Burien, good band. I mean, they've been
not really new.
It seems like a lot of the bands that I would like have actually, you know, maybe they put out new records, but I mean, there's. I saw The Pharmacy the other night in their 10-year anniversary show.
How was that?
It was absolutely fantastic. Or Scott Yoder, the singer, he does shows and has new music out. I mean, these guys are not, you know, I wish I could come up with a band of 19-year-olds that I knew about that were killer, and I don't have that. But
yeah, I'm sure that they're there. I don't know them either.
The Lemon Twigs. I mean, they're not 19 anymore. But
oh, yeah. That's what I would say.
Those guys are ready to, like, get AARP. Like,
they
got their cards last week.
They're great.
They are. They're going to be here when we're out of town, unfortunately, in November. Or
those
October.
Guys are probably 30 now, right?
No. Mid-20s.
Young 20s.
Mid-20s.
No, they were like 28 years ago.
Yeah, no, they were like 19.
You want us to look?
19.
Go ahead, let's fact check.
Okay.
All
right,
let's
do it right now.
That is an awesome band. I got to see them in New York. Like, yeah.
They're so good.
A couple of times and love their records. Yeah. So cool. Yeah.
They're like, you know, revivalists, I guess.
Well, it's basically, to me, it's like Red Cross redone. Yeah. As of May 2022, they're 19 and 17.
Is that right?
2023. Yeah. 19 and 17.
Yeah, they're young kids.
See? No.
Children.
I'm reading. Right here, as of May 2023, they were 19 and 17. Brian and Michael. So there you have it.
The internet is always correct.
Like at least 25.
No.
Over the hill.
I kind of thought they were a little older too.
AARP material.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So yeah, that would be who I would pick. Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah. Whoever it was that brought that up. They're awesome.
Big shout out to the Lemon Twig.
Yeah. And can you start listening to the Fastbacks? That was one thing I was going to say, which is going to sound really corny, but my favorite record, and I kid you not, is the Fastbacks record right now. I listen to that all the time, and in all the time we've been a band, I've never listened to our records.
Is that right?
Yeah, I'm sure it's that's the best right. record.
What did we do wrong?
No, I never. Whatever. Yes.
Well, let's talk about the record. So you guys have a new approach,
a new long player.
You guys have reached your Beatles phase. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Completely.
Studio only band.
Studio band.
Yes, I don't want to play shows anymore.
Right. So. I don't blame you.
But that's not new. I guess some people.
It's our Sgt. Pepper's.
Yeah, that's been going on for a while, so that's not a new thing. It's just probably going to seem weird. Like, so you're putting out a new record of 25 years and no shows. Like, yep.
And we're getting a lot of offers for shows.
Is that right?
Are we?
Is there any amount of money that would bring you out of retirement from shows?
Because once you open that door, I don't want to,
Right, once you open that door, you put a little stone or a piece of tape in it.
There's
it,
I'm not going to put
a piece of tape
paper over it.
Nothing will be put in that door.
Yeah, no deadbolts on that one, unfortunately, once you...
So
once you guys as a group negotiated the idea that no more shows, was there any hesitation of like, well, do we still make a record? Or was it like,
that
record let's make a record?
Came about at lunch. We were at lunch and it was because of that Seeker song.
And Mike.
And Mike. But we,
that's the reason.
Kurt had fallen in love with the song we recorded called There'll Never Be Another You by the Seekers. And he sent it to me. He was on Tour and Tour with the Young Fresh Fellows, I believe, when you heard that song. First, you're in the van, you're listening to a folk compilation.
Go on.
And you had COVID, you didn't feel good, but you liked that song and you sent it to me. And I listened to it like, oh, I remember this song. This is a great song. And then somehow it got sent around to all of us, and we all just loved that song. And I don't know, like, we should record that song. And you said,
what is that, Lunch? It's like, can we just make a record?
Yeah, he said it.
And then I, no.
And then I turned to Kurt and said, do you have any more songs? He said, no, but I could see if I could find some.
No, I just said, no, I don't know. Let's not make a record. Let's not record. Let's just finish Lunch and go home and go about our business.
But it did.
Yeah. So none of this business.
Let's record a cover song.
Well, but we didn't even really, we just kind of mentioned it in passing. It wasn't like we were going to actually go do it.
And we did have a couple other songs that had already been recorded in the previous couple of years that were just sort of sitting there.
We've done that single
Quiet Night. And then, and Kurt had one other, or we did, I shouldn't say Kurt, but Kurt knew that we had one other song that had been recorded when we did Zucker and had never been released. And so it was like, oh, we got two songs.
Zucker.
Wasn't it Zucker? Or what was it?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, no, I'm sorry.
The last song on the record.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, sorry, wrong.
World Inside.
Yeah.
World Inside.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
2001.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Zucker.
So the, so the last.
Only off by 20 years. Yeah. That's cool.
I had a song that I wrote in 2012 that had just been sitting around. I didn't know how to finish it. So that was offered up.
Yeah. And Kurt turned out he had a few songs hanging around.
After all, after somebody talked him into saying, okay, I will do it.
Yeah.
If I remember correctly, we were having one of our, you know, once every couple months lunches, and somebody said, well, we should go record. And Mike said, well, I'm going to call Joe.
And we're at the New Leaf Bistro.
And see if he's got any time we could go record. And
Joe's studio was brand new and amazing, and I wanted to go play drums in that room.
And so,
really bad.
Yeah, and so you know, Mike signed us up for 2 days of recording, which was about a month in advance. So it's like, well, we got a couple days of recording. We better get busy and figure out what it is we're going to record.
And also, this day, it was basically a year ago.
Yeah, we
2 days before today. It was a year ago that we recorded that record. So we've had it for like a year.
I remember I had just gotten back and you told me that you were going in. And I had been over to Joe's and done a little bit of work. So I was aware that you guys were tracking drums over there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It was exciting.
It still is.
Well, yeah. It is because it's not even out yet. Yeah. But it's like, at this point, it's like classic rock. I've heard it so many times that it's funny that it's a new record.
Yeah,
it's classic rock because it's been around for a year.
Yeah.
Because now it's only a year before it turns into classic rock.
Time speeds up.
Sure does. The older you get.
Is that the first... full, is that the first contribution, like songwriting contribution?
Yeah.
That you've made to a Fastbacks record?
Yeah, I've never had a song on a Fastbacks record.
Since 1981.
I've never had a song of mine on a record.
Yeah, what was that song? Yeah, there's one song.
On that compilation, Now Is the Time Comp.
No.
That's a way less good story. We're gonna go with this.
Yeah, it's way better.
I don't know. I don't think I've ever had a song on a record, but maybe.
How does that feel?
Great.
Yeah.
But now I want to do more, and that's why I don't write songs. I get so frustrated that I want to do another good one, and if I can't, like always in life, I just walk away. Like fuck it. I'm not gonna try. I don't want to. It's just what happens. Maybe this time it'll be different.
Right.
Because it was good. It's fun.
Can we make another record?
That's what I want to do.
Well, that was your answer last time. Do you think that's actually the truth?
So maybe that's a good answer.
I think, yes, it is the truth.
It's a good thing it's on video.
For now.
You can refer to it. You can go through the surveillance video. See, you said no. At 1 hour, 14 minutes, and 12 seconds, the answer is no.
Wait, hopefully no, we already made a record called The Answer Is No.
Really? I didn't put two and two together there.
The answer is no, part do.
Yeah.
The question is no. The answer is you. Yeah.
The answer is when. What do you guys plan to do about other than you got the Easy Street thing, you've got this illustrious conversation being captured.
We have
an
interview in this for the Stranger.
Stranger. Yeah.
Coming up this week.
We're doing that this week.
Public performances.
No.
No.
One public appearance.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We're going to do some more videos as well.
Videos is fun.
Yeah.
Yeah,
making more videos.
It's cute.
She does it.
It's cute, exactly.
We're all in-house production here.
So it's easy
enough.
But
people will be able to see a performance of some sort.
I love the car video.
Yeah, good. That's Lulu.
It's like super simple and effective. And here it is. It's like, and it's fun. What it does is it embodies the spirit of the band.
That was the goal. I thought it fit the song. In fact, we were going to do another video first, but then I came, coming up with the video concepts is like, okay. And that one kind of came to mind, but I thought it fit that song better. So that's why we did that one first.
Yeah, it's like a good song to drive around and sing along with.
Right. Will you make a video for every song?
I hope not.
Can down the road of making a new record. Let's just make another video.
Who knows?
Yeah, I mean, who knows?
None
of us are really big on making videos, and that includes me, even though I make them. But it's not one of my favorite things to do. But it's an effective way to just get the music out there and have people see us too, and hopefully they'll get the record because it's really good. Like I said, these guys are getting tired of me saying that. it's a really good record.
I agree with you.
Yeah, I agree too.
But I'm the one who just always, this is the best record ever.
Right.
Yeah.
I listened to it the other day and it's really fucking amazing.
Yeah,
it's
see? Great.
I think it's absolutely killer.
Yeah.
Good.
Oh, you've heard it.
I sent it to him. I sent it to him yesterday.
Of course.
Oh, you mean you've only had it for 24 hours?
It is here.
So basically, you kind of.
It's here.
Oh, let's put that up for show and tell.
Yeah.
There you go.
Show and tell. I love that.
Just so you know.
And the back.
What? And there's
at Joe's studio.
There's Joe's studio. There's a Temple of the Trees.
So it tells the whole story right there, front
tells
and back.
Tells the truth right there. Yeah, yeah.
It's the whole truth and nothing but.
There's no question about that. That is true.
When does the record come out?
28th of August.
August 28th.
28th to 29th. I mean, we're at Easy Street on... August 29th.
Yes, the record will be a day old. That
oh, my God.
We'll be selling copies for cheap because it'll be on fire sale.
For whatever reason, like, my whole schedule has been a month off. I thought that your guys' thing at Easy Street was...
July?
Like, yeah. I was in a panic.
No.
Well, we would be too.
You got your hang up, man.
Don't try to push us around like that.
Look, I'm not prepared to be psychoanalyzed right now. And I don't think you have the capacity to take on this load.
Yeah. Yeah. You want a piece of that? Yeah. You have to wait. Get in line.
Mike.
Yes.
As the new guy.
Mm-hmm. For 30 years. I did come and go.
As the Ronnie Wood of the Fastbacks.
Exactly.
tell me about your adventure in this band and coming and going. And do I remember this right? Finn played some shows in the 90s?
Later, when I left.
Yeah, he didn't go on tour with us.
No. Well, he played in San Francisco with you guys.
Oh, that's right.
Your last
Bottom of the Hill
show,
that's
right?
True. Yeah, he did.
Yeah. It's a long story. I first saw the Fastbacks in high school at the Mural Amphitheater.
Not Nathan Hale.
And loved it because I was in that part of my life and when I just was loving new music and thought it was fucking cool. I think Richard Struver was playing drums at the time and they were great. And then I started working at a record store called Peaches in the University District. Literally, I think, what year did... And his orchestra get actually released? 87?
87.
87. And I think we had an in-store play, copy to play in the store at Peaches. And I remember playing it all the time in fall of 87, because that's when I started working at Peaches.
I don't think I ever heard it in Peaches.
Yeah, we played it all the time. We played that and the Guns N' Roses record, well, Appetite for Destruction.
Of course.
And the Cure record, Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me. Those three records that we just played constantly every afternoon. And then, you know, I met them, my band opened for them, played shows with them, starting in, I think the first one was 88, also at the Mural Amphitheater. And I remember trying to talk to you, but you were not having it.
I was not well.
Not well, no. And then when they kind of needed a drummer, because Nate was not their drummer anymore, and I started literally campaigning to be their drummer for all three of them for like almost a year and a half, and they did not take me seriously at all.
Oh my gosh.
Well, who was our drummer at that point?
You didn't really have
one. We didn't have one. I don't think.
And you weren't doing anything. And then, you know, you had Rusty. Rusty was, and you know, you guys recorded Zucker. But before that, I was like, I would bug Kurt at whatever drunkenly at some bar. I was like, if you ever need a drummer,
can I be in your band?
Literally, I was like, can I be in your band? And all of you guys individually at one point or another just kind of like, away. And then one day finally I was asked to go play a show. And yeah.
What was the first show?
Good question.
Kurt?
What was my first show?
I could look it up.
I think the
calendars are pretty accurate.
Yeah. What was the first show? Scott. I mean, there was a trip down to Portland, and remember Ed Fotheringham came with us, I think.
Oh, yes.
That's my first out of town trip with you guys. Oh, you know what my first show was? It was a Pop-Lama Picnic at Volunteer Park. Wasn't that my first show?
Oh,
that
my god!
Crazy
gosh.
Day at, you yeah, know, that picture that's on the back of it.
With the walkabouts, yeah, Dharma Bums
and Posies. That, you know, the photos on the back cover of
Jim Silva.
Yeah, of the Gone to the Moon single. Is a photo. I think
that one. Oh,
yeah,
that one.
Not
yeah.
the Martha, not
We're
the Martha
all in shorts.
Lake right, right, right. one. I was
that
at that.
That was the first one, the one that's on the back.
I think that was my first show with you guys. It was the Pop-Lama Picnic at Volunteer Park.
I wish there was a tape of that.
Did the Young Fresh Fellows really play that?
They did.
What's that?
Did the Young Fresh Fellows
yes.
play that?
They did.
Yeah, yeah.
They were the headliner.
I think it was both those bands.
Paul Westerberg was
there. I know, he was skulking around, hiding in the van.
And yeah, and then I've been in this band ever since. Although I have had to leave and go do other things because other bands I was in would be busy, and so they'd get other drummers to fill in, and then I'd come back.
If it makes you feel any better, Mike.
What?
I've had to basically beg my way into every band also.
Yeah, yeah. I literally begged my way, and they finally relented.
We just got tired of it. Finally, like, come on.
God, like, this fucking kid playing our band.
Yeah. It wore us down.
It's key.
Yeah.
My camera's batteries have all died because we have been going.
Okay. How can you tell they Where all did? I see red. That one.
See that one's throwing you an error message.
Yep.
So the rest of this interview will be done in the dark.
Well, but you don't want to miss Mike's.
Yeah, it's all right.
The recording, the multi-track recording still continues. Oh,
the audio. Yeah.
It's plugged in.
Yeah, Sally's fourth.
Yeah,
you can just take a still fill a frame of just my face in a weird contortion and as my
no, but really over. Small, like the black frame, but just this little tiny picture of Mike in the center. Sorry.
We will be back in just a moment.
Yeah. No way.
Yeah.
Actually, we won't be back because we'll never, I know you're
or
not.
Maybe there will be just a title that says, "Sorry, we're having technical difficulties."
I could run that. Emergency broadcast system report.
This is only a test.
In the middle of Mike's talking.
Is there anything, like, I'm not sure what else to hit. Like, we could go back and hit more highlights, but is there anything that you guys want to touch on that... 45 years is a long fucking time to be a band. Good Lord.
But it wasn't constant.
It's still...
I know. It's still pretty amazing, but, there's been many years where we weren't doing anything.
Sure.
But still, that we're still here is saying something.
Right.
Yeah, we're alive.
Yeah, that's also something.
I mean, that's also something.
Yeah.
We've all seen a lot of people go.
Yeah.
I think we all recognize that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and here's to them.
Yeah. Is that a part of the perspective on life and music?
Not really. I mean, I think we realize it, but I don't know.
I think it is for me.
Fuck, it is for me.
Yeah, I think it is for me.
I'm happy to still be here. For sure.
Sure.
I think I'm much more grateful just to be here on the planet. and get to do what we do, right?
It's funny to be a punk and a hippie.
It's a riot. That's a great one.
Express gratitude.
It's exactly. Sorry, but I don't know if Kurt would fall into that category. Hippie, what are you talking?
He's the punkest hippie I know.
What are you talking about?
Comment withheld.
I have to say, and you guys can take this. You can accept it as you like. You guys are an inspiration.
Thank you. That's all I can say.
Yeah, that's okay.
No, that's amazing.
45 years. I've never done anything for 45 years.
Yet.
I've been able to walk for 45 years. Over 45 years.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
You know?
There was a period when you couldn't walk, though.
There was a time. Yeah. It's true. That's
not
true.
To bring that up, time, but yes.
Isn't it? I just started to do the math.
Don't.
We all know people
Do the math. Yeah. Don't name it.
Who didn't hit age 45? You know, they didn't make it that far.
Yeah.
I hope that you guys decide to capture more Fastbacks music and release it in the future. I think what better way to honor your friendship? And
I agree with that.
Yeah. What a better excuse to get together for lunch.
Well, yeah, we always find
lunch anytime.
I mean, it's birthdays, lunches for sure. And then it started off with just giving us records that you'd put out.
Well, right.
And we'd go have lunch and give us records and.
There were a lot of re-releases during COVID.
Yeah.
Thanks to Kurt.
But the luncheons are good. They roll on.
Do you guys have a regular spot?
So sort of that New Leaf Bistro.
In West Seattle. Yeah, that's good.
But I mean, go to different places.
I think that's where we... Or was it... No, maybe it was that other...
What's the other Thai place over there?
Yeah, Arthur's. That might have been where we decided to do the record. I don't remember. Or was it the...
Arthur's. I think it was Arthur's where we had that conversation.
Why didn't
we give them a dedication or anything?
Who?
Arthur's.
A shout out, you mean?
A shout out. Yeah. Thank you.
They don't dedicate you shout
Nothing
out.
Nothing dedicated to those guys.
Casey Kasem does,
dedications. No, we do shout outs. We're a little more modern.
Is that right?
Yes.
You guys thinking about a collab?
I gotta do a mashup.
Well, I don't even know if I said it right.
I don't either.
Probably not.
Collab. Featuring.
Right.
Gotta get one of those on a record. Featuring.
You guys, I don't know what else to talk about.
Well, we have no cameras.
We don't have cameras. That's fine.
About this Motorhead show.
Oh, yeah. That was actually from a tour that Loaded did with Motorhead.
I'm glad they put the guitar solo on there in case
forgotten to take a solo.
Yeah, that's funny.
Great that they play song? Overkill last.
Yeah.
The giant pick.
It's pretty
good. They were the most fun band to tour with, and they're so funny. There's a legendary story. It didn't happen on our tour, but there's a story about Mickey D does a big long drum solo, and Phil took everyone to the pub across the street from the club as soon as the drum solo started.
Like the whole audience? Or just everyone backstage?
And he's a legendary funny man.
That's so good.
How about that?
That's a good story.
That's a good gag. Yeah. He's the gag man. Yeah. That was a fun tour. Tough tour. That's a tour in Germany. That's a tough band to open up for in general.
Uh-huh.
What kind of places?
People, it doesn't matter who you are, they don't want to.
Let's just say they all had metal stages.
What kind of venues were they?
Well, they were like giant, more cavernous versions of Showbox Soto.
Yeah.
You know, like big old, like they were like.
That's not one of my favorite
industrial
places.
Industrial rooms.
Is it bigger than the Showbox?
Yeah.
I hate that.
They were all rooms that used to build
Oh, the one in the south, you know, is way worse.
And stuff, I'm sure.
Yeah, the soda were all factory.
That's why they started warehouse spaces.
With bomber, yeah, that's right. That's right.
Because it was in a room that built bombers.
Probably. Yeah, so
I think that's
that was a photo. One of my favorite photo things is when Girl School was touring, and Lemmy came on tour with them. They weren't playing, correct? With them, but they came. And I have some great pictures of Duff McKagan, who's like 17, and he's just sort of standing there, all like really embarrassed with the girls surrounding him.
So in love with Kelly Johnson, and they did that in store at Tower on the Ave. And Duff still says this. We still laugh about that. He is in there. And he was a kid, you know, drunk probably in the daytime. And he was barefoot. And they kicked him out. And he's like, no barefoot skis.
Duff was barefoot?
Yeah, it was summer. Just running around, dumb, up and down the Ave. But anyway, no barefoot skis. Duff's like, I got to go. No barefoot skis. Like,
barefoot on the Ave.
I don't know. Yeah, I didn't think of it.
No, isn't that funny
has
now?
Never been.
Yeah,
this one's new.
You gotta wonder if anybody would do that.
On the Ave. Foot skis.
No barefoot skis.
No barefoot skis. Called barefoot on the Ave. Hope you.
I'm
like
gonna shout out to the
nice good foot ski.
I'm gonna give a shout out to the Ave.
Shout out to the Ave.
Shout out Spaceport in this one.
And. Orange Julius.
Orange Julius.
Slew Kim.
Yeah, I don't think the girls' school entourage made it to Orange Julius that time.
They did not.
Or the Coffee Corral.
Nope.
You guys?
On that note, once you bring
I'd go to the Coffee Corral if it was open right now. I'd go there.
What was that?
Coffee Corral was on 42nd University Way.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't
that
side?
Where Espresso Aroma ended up when it opened? Is that the same spot on the corner?
Across the Ave was on the.
It was kind of kitty corner, wasn't it?
Corner.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Well, southeast.
Coffee Corral was different space.
Yeah, you're right.
But it was
just
a restaurant.
Yeah, I remember.
And next door to that was the Orange Julius.
Orange Julius.
Yeah. I'd only ever
so it was
been
southwest.
To the
west
to buy
was
drugs.
It was southwest.
That's,
the only,
like, that's all I ever was there.
We were there every day.
For years.
We'd go there to Selvin Square.
Coffee shop.
Buy like used records, take them home, and maybe record them.
Take them back
and sell them. But they weren't very good. But we were constantly. It was just constantly.
But Orange Julius was on 42nd
but every
and
day
west
we'd
of
go
the
there.
Ave.
Me, Kurt,
wrong?
No, it was east.
Wow.
Yeah, it was
okay.
Like,
Square was west of
it was on the side.
Oh, right. Yeah, okay. I'm sorry.
And then Flowers by Wire
yes,
was on
yes,
the other corner
yeah,
where
okay,
Sats
was. Sorry.
I like that place because I was a hippie.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You were
it was an actual. Well, we used to be an actual flower shop.
Yeah,
right.
And Sats, the singer from the Lude, worked there, and we were always hanging out in Ave. And sometimes during the summer, they'd have their back door open, and
Sats.
And you'd see Sats back there cutting flowers and stuff. It's like, whoa.
He delivered. He's a
punk rocker. And we'd go
cutting
back
flowers.
Sats.
To see if we'd get his attention cutting flowers.
I think I was scared of him. I didn't ever know him. He seemed kind of scary. But I didn't know.
Fastbacks?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I wish you guys the best of luck in everything that you ever do. I think you guys are a gift to Seattle and to the world.
It keeps on giving.
And I want you guys to have a great life.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you,
Mr. Squires.
And thanks for having us. Thank you for having us.
Right back at you.
Shout out to Mike Squires.
S/O.
We'd like to dedicate this to
shout out to Caltrips.
Yeah.
What was the restaurant?
Oh, shout out to the Coffee Corral.
Coffee Corral.
The one where you guys decided to make the record.
Oh, Arthur's.
Shout out to Arthur's.
Wasn't at Arthur's that we decided to make the record.
It was New Leaf Bistro.
Yeah, whatever the other.
Shout out to
NLB. Yeah, you might be right.
Yeah. West Seattle in general.
That's right, because it was two separate things. There was a little sort of embryo of a thought. And then
shout out to Joe Reinecke. Without him saying yes to letting us record there, we may never have even done it.
Yep. A lot of shout outs today. And shout out to everybody who's listening. Yeah. Thank yourself.
Shout out to people who are hard of hearing.
A little louder there.
Good one. Whee!